In Washington, D.C., and the historic trilateral summit between the U.S., Japan, and the Philippines, where long simmering tensions between China and its neighbors took center stage. We have this report from Voice of America correspondent Chris Casquejo.
U.S. President Joe Biden reiterated his vow that the U.S. defense agreements with the Philippines and Japan are ironclad. So let's start with the Philippines, which is a key part of the U.S. defense strategy in the region. No troops from the U.S. are permanently stationed there, and the U.S. and the Philippines have a mutual defense treaty that dates back to 1951. Last year in 2023, they agreed upon four additional sites under the 2014 Enhanced Defense Cooperation Agreement, EDCA, to provide additional staging capacity for U.S. military, where U.S. troops rotate their presence no more than 10,000 at a time. And the Philippines also needs to retrofit its military assets. So to that end, the U.S. Senate has proposed $2.5 billion in grants over 5 years to help Manila purchase weapons from Washington.
Today, we mark a historic moment, the first ever leaders summit between the United States, Japan, and the Philippines. And it's truly an honor to have you both here as we begin this new era of a partnership. And today, we commit to writing that story in the future together, to building the Indo-Pacific that is free, open, prosperous, and secure for all. And I want to be clear, the United States defense commitments to Japan and to the Philippines are ironclad. They're ironclad. As I've said before, any attack on Philippine aircraft, vessels, or armed forces in the South China Sea would invoke our mutual defense treaty.
We meet today as friends and partners bound by a shared vision and pursuit of a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries. This is a meeting that looks ahead. As we deepen our ties and enhance our coordination, we seek to identify ways of growing our economies and making them more resilient, climate-proofing our cities and our societies, sustaining our development progress, and forging a peaceful world for the next generation.
Now on to Japan, which has 50,000 U.S. troops stationed there, but command and control for those forces is located in Hawaii. The U.S. and Japan committed on Wednesday to better coordinate their military command and control with some reforms. And this is all in the hope of discouraging China's so-called gray zone tactics, like firing water cannons in the West Philippine Sea or South China Sea and aiming military-grade lasers at other vessels. Reporting from the White House, Chris Casquejo, VOA News.
Well, the trilateral summit has concluded with Manila receiving several pledges of aid from Tokyo and Washington, including the opening of an economic corridor in Luzon. Katrina Domingo has the story, and she's reporting live from Washington, D.C. to give us details. Kat, go ahead.
Hi, Stanley. The Philippines trilateral partnership with Japan and the United States is expected to produce more jobs and more investments that will ultimately benefit Filipinos. That was the guarantee of U.S. President Joe Biden during the trilateral summit that happened here earlier. Now, based on the joint visual statement that was released after that historic summit, the three countries have agreed to open the Luzon Corridor, which is basically a string of investments and developments that will connect Subic Bay, Clark, Manila, and Batangas. Among the Luzon Corridor projects that the U.S. and Japan will help fund are the Subic-Clark-Manila-Batangas railway system, the expansion of the Clark International Airport, and the Clark National Food Hub, which will be the central drop-off point for agricultural products in the region, both for export and domestic consumption. Now, the Development Finance Corporation, which is the United States' financing arm for developing nations, will also open its first office in the Philippines to help steer the development of the Luzon Corridor. Let's listen to a portion of President Biden's speech.
The first corridor in Indo-Pacific people across the entire region. It needs more investment. The sector is critical to our future. Clean energy, ports, railroads,
agriculture, and much more.
Now, President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. underscores that Manila's cooperation with Tokyo and Washington came from their shared vision and pursuit of a peaceful, stable, and prosperous Indo-Pacific. Let's listen to his statement.
It is a partnership born not out of convenience nor of expediency, but as a natural progression of a deepening relation and robust cooperation amongst our three countries.
Linked by a profound respect for democracy, good governance, and the rule of law.
This is a meeting that looks ahead. As we deepen our ties and enhance our coordination, we seek to identify ways of growing our economies and making them more resilient, climate-proofing our cities and our societies, sustaining our development progress, and forging a peaceful world for the next generation.
Stanley, the Japan and the U.S. have also committed to provide training programs for Filipino students who wish to work in the semiconductor industry to help the Philippines expand one of its most profitable sectors. On the defense front, the three allies condemned China for its illegal presence and dangerous tactics inside the Philippines' exclusive economic zone. The three countries have also agreed to mount joint naval training exercises, including maritime drills around Japan in 2025. The joint vision statement also mentioned the three countries' united stance on the civil and safe use of nuclear power, as well as a vow to uphold democratic values, human rights, and gender equality. Stanley, so far, we expect to get more details about this trilateral partnership later on, as President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is expected to answer several questions from the media tomorrow before his return flight to Manila. Stanley.
All right, we're looking forward to those developments. Katrina Domingo again, thank you so much for the updates. Former President Rodrigo Duterte setting the record straight on his alleged gentleman's agreement with China. During a press conference aired on SMNI's Facebook page, Duterte said he conceded nothing to China during his administration. But he says Manila and Beijing did agree to maintain the status quo in the West Philippine Sea.
Aside from the fact of having a handshake with President Xi Jinping, the only thing I remember was that status quo. That's the word. Na walang galawan. No movement. No armed patrols there. As is where is. Para walang magkagulo. Hindi tayo magkagulo. Yun ang naalaala ko.
Kaya Tano Alan. A Senate probe on the alleged deal has been sought, with some critics of the former president calling the agreement treasonous and unconstitutional. President Marcos also said he was horrified by the deal. China again calling on the Philippines to honor a supposed promise and an agreement in their maritime row. Beijing insists the Philippines reneged on its promise to tow away the BRP Sierra Madre from the Ayungin Shoal. It also slams the Philippine government for denying reaching an agreement with China during the Duterte administration. China continues to claim Manila is, one, provoking Beijing by bringing construction materials to the BRP Sierra Madre, the lone Navy outpost of the Philippines in the West Philippine Sea.
China has been working with the Philippines to manage the situation on the Rinnai Reef through dialogue and consultation. The reasons for the current situation on the Rinnai Reef are clear and obvious. If the Philippines truly wants to ease the situation on the Rinnai Reef through dialogue and communication, it should honor its promise, abide by consensus, and stop provocations.
Former President Rodrigo Duterte revealing the possible location of fugitive pastor Apollo Quiboloy. Duterte said Quiboloy might be hiding in the Kingdom of Jesus Christ's properties in Tamayong Village in Calinan, Davao City. But Duterte warned it may be challenging for authorities to search the area given its vast size. Duterte's revelation came after he denied he is coddling and hiding Quiboloy in his house. The former president also said he would not accept the pastor if he will surrender to him.